Good evening. It's time. It's time to be revived. Amen. Amen. Anybody feel like giving God some praise today? Amen. Amen. Let us stand for our prayer for our service this evening. Our 131st revival. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Father God, we come, O gracious God, thanking you for this hour, for this time, this moment in history, O God. We thank you that you've brought Oak Grove Baptist Church, O God, and kept Oak Grove for 131 years. We thank you now, O God, for the saints that you've sent, O gracious God, to worship you. We pray, O gracious God, for the manservant that you've blessed us with. We pray for our pastor, O gracious God. We pray, O Heavenly Father, for those here at this edifice that you've blessed us with. We pray, God, for those who are on Facebook and those who are teleconferencing in, O God. We pray now, thanking you for your word. Thank you for your word. Your word says, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. So, Father, we pray and ask that you free us now. Free us, O God, our minds and our hearts, that we might not worry and think about no other thing but you. Keep us in your presence, where we'll be at peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's give God some praise here. Amen. Amen. We have the Unity Choir. We have the Unity Choir that will give us our praise and worship.
Amen. Amen.
All right, y'all going to sing?
Amen. Amen.
Y'all going to sing?
Hallelujah.
Go on and sing now.
Yeah.
Amen.
Don't sit down yet. We just about ready to get our praise on up in the house today.
Hallelujah.
I will bless the Lord.
things for me. He has done great things for me. He has done great things for me. He has done great things for me. So I will bless the Lord. Bless the Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Great things for me.
Hallelujah, yeah, hallelujah, yeah, yeah. Hallelujah.
Almost 50 years worth. Yes. Hallelujah. Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Testing.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Tonight,
I shall have what I decree.
Yes, I believe.
It belongs to me.
I shall have
what I decree.
Yes, I believe.
It belongs to me. So I'm going to
speak into the atmosphere.
Whatever God said, we're going to speak into the atmosphere.
Speak into the atmosphere.
Into the atmosphere.
I shall have
what I decree.
Yes, I believe.
It belongs to me.
I shall have
what I decree.
Yes, I believe.
It belongs to me. So I'm going to
speak into the atmosphere.
I'm going to speak it into the atmosphere.
Speak into the atmosphere.
So this is what we're going to do. We're going to speak it.
Declare 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 it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it. Declare it
Speak it into the atmosphere.
Speak into the atmosphere.
We're gonna speak it into the atmosphere.
Speak into the atmosphere.
We're gonna speak it into the atmosphere.
Speak into the atmosphere.
I shall have
what I decree.
Yes, I believe
it belongs to me.
I shall have what I decree.
Yes, I believe
it belongs to me. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. Let's say it one more time so I can hear you. Amen. Speak into the atmosphere. Speak into the atmosphere. Y'all, that's the unity choir. Huh? Y'all did come to sing. Amen. Amen. Speak into the atmosphere. Let me do my job now. I've been called to do the call to worship. Amen. Now the call to worship. You know, the Black Baptist Church, we like call and responses as well, amen? So our call to worship, I want y'all to respond to the call today as well, okay? All right? So bear with me here. Our call to worship is the 100th song. The 100th song. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. I can't hear you, church. Make a joyful noise. Amen. Amen. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. With singing. I'm from the country. For with singing, y'all. We used to sing it. Y'all sang. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We ain't self-made, y'all. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. And into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. Now catch this now. Catch this. For the Lord is good. I said the Lord is good. I said the Lord is good. That's for our Facebook folks and those on teleconference. The Lord is good. You know why he's good? Because his mercy is everlasting. And his truth endureth. What y'all think about it? Endure to all generations, forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Amen. Amen. We're going to have our hymn of praise by our unity choir, and then I'll come back with the invocation. Amen. Thank you. by. Y'all got any oxygen back there? Anybody got any oxygen? Y'all, for an old man, y'all gonna have to put me on some oxygen here. Amen, amen. Sing choir, sing choir. Let us pray. Father, we thank you. If we had 1,000 tongues, God, we couldn't thank you enough. We thank you, God, for waking us up this morning. Thank you for the lifeblood running warmly in our veins. Thank you that we were able to pivot and put our feet on the floor. We were able to rise up, oh God. We were able to go to our closets and find clothes, to our pantry to find food, oh God. Thank you, God. Thank you for all your blessings. Lord, we come now, oh gracious God. We come, oh heavenly Father. We would normally say we invoke the presence of the Holy Spirit. But I come tonight, oh God, asking that you, God, allow us in your presence. Oh God, that you bring us into your presence where we can find peace. Then God, let us worship you. Let us worship you in spirit and in truth. Bless your people. Bless the man's servant. Bless our pastor. Bless Oak Grove, oh gracious God. Bless those who are on Facebook and those who are teleconferencing, oh God. Let your word go forward that it might convince, that it might commit, that someone might hear a word that will convict them. Hear now our prayer. In the name of Jesus. We pray and ask it all. Amen. 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 Our scripture for the day will be read by Deacon Smith, Deacon Everett Smith. Our prayer will be given by Deacon Willard Hill. I like calling them by their full names. And then we'll have our welcome by Deacon Orr. And then our choir will come back with a selection. Amen. Remember that call and response. Amen. 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 Amen.
Good evening, everyone. Happy revival. So today's scripture will be coming from Romans 10, verses 1 through 10. I'll give everyone on Facebook Live and on the conference call time to find that. Again, that's Romans 10, verses 1 through 10, and I'll be reading from the King James Version. And it reads as thus, "Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. For Moses described the righteousness which is of the law, that the man which doeth these things shall live by them. But the righteousness which is of faith speaketh on this wise, say not in thine heart, who shall ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down from above? Or who shall descend into the deep, that is to bring up Christ again from the dead? But what saith it? The Lord is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thine heart, that is the word of faith which we preach. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved." Final verse, For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with thy mouth, with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. God's word for God's people.
Let us bow our heads and prepare for prayer. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and grief to bear. What a privilege it is to carry everything to God in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, it is once again that we, a few of your children, have assembled ourselves together in your house. We come with bowed heads, with humble hearts, thanking you for the many blessings that you have bestowed upon us. Lord, we come just saying we thank you tonight because we have so many things to thank you for. Even with all of the bad news that we hear from time to time, we still realize that we are blessed, and we come to say we thank you. Lord, you've been good to us. You watched over us down through the years and even up until this present moment. You kept your arms of protection around us. And we just want to say thank you. Now, Lord, I pray that you look into Oak Grove Baptist Church tonight. We pray that you look upon your people. We realize that we need you. No matter who we are, we still have a need for you. We ask you to look into our hearts and create within us clean hearts. Create within us the right spirit that we might be able to serve you and to worship you, Heavenly Father. Lord, I pray for Oak Grove Baptist Church tonight. Ask you to remember our pastor. Remember each officer one by one, each member, each visitor, each well-wisher. Have mercy upon them in a very special way. Now, Lord, we have sickness in our congregation, and I know that you know everyone by name. You made them, and you know what's wrong with them. But, Lord, I've come to understand that it's not always what the doctors say, Lord. It's what you say. So we ask you to bless them in a very special manner. I realize that nothing is too hard for you. When the doctors give that diagnosis, Heavenly Father, you are still in control. You created the doctors. You gave them the wisdom. You gave them the use of scientists and medicine, but still you are in control. And we come tonight believing that you will hear. Hear our prayers and you will answer our prayers and remember those that are sick. Remember those that are in the hospital. Those that are confined to their homes, Heavenly Father. Have mercy upon them, I pray. Now, Lord, there are those that are going through some, so many are being faced with eviction because of the situations that the pandemic has brought about. But I know that you are a way maker, Heavenly Father. When everything else seemed not to work, you will step in at the right time. So I ask you to bless them in a very special way. Then, Lord, there are those that are already homeless. Bless them, I pray. Bless those that are hungry. There are children that have not eaten today, Lord. I pray that you would just have mercy upon them in a very special way. Be with them and stand by them. Now, Lord, I pray that you bless this revival in a very special way. I pray for the preacher who will preach tonight, Heavenly Father. Speak through him that he might speak to us. Then I pray that you give us receptive minds, receptive hearts, that we will receive your word. And Lord, I'm a strong believer that as we learn better, we should do better. Help us to receive your word and that it will improve our lives. Be with us, stand by us, have mercy upon us, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, everyone. It's morning somewhere in the world, okay? Well, good evening and welcome to Oak Grove Baptist Church. I'm here to welcome all of our visitors in Facebook land, those who are tuning in by teleconference, and of course, all of you are here. I just want to say on behalf of our pastor, the Reverend Dr. Franklin D. Watkins, our ministers, our First Lady, our deacons, the congregation, the choir, even down to the Genesis, welcome, welcome, welcome. Now, if you're here for the first, second, or even the third time, will you please stand so we can properly acknowledge you? Any first, second, or third time visitors? Okay, well, we're all family. So family, just to remind you of a couple of things. Most of you know this already, but when you walk into the sanctuary, you know the men's restroom is on the right-hand side, the ladies' restroom is on the left-hand side. You do notice we did take a temperature when you first came in. Of course, we wanted to keep in alignment with COVID-19. If you forgot your mask, we do have extra masks in the lobby there, so feel free to grab one. There are hand sanitizers all around. Now, at this point, we just want you to relax, kick off your shoes, enjoy yourself. And if you don't, we got security that can investigate why you're not doing that. So just kick back, let go, and let God. And again, welcome, welcome, welcome.
Teleconference. We bless you this evening. Someone left their rings in the women's restroom. If you took your rings off and left them on the counter, we have your rings. Okay. Oh, that's the newlywed. She forgot. Okay. We're going to go to God in prayer for our offertory prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this evening with grateful and humble hearts. We ask, Lord, that you just bless each and every person that's here, every person in the sound of my voice. Heavenly Father, we ask that you bless those that are able to give this evening, those that gave on yesterday, those will give tomorrow. Heavenly Father, we ask that you just bless each and every one of us. Heavenly Father, we ask that you just give us the wisdom and knowledge to use your gifts according to your will and your way for the upbuilding of your kingdom. Heavenly Father, just bless us and keep us is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, we would do our offering by sections, section 1, 2, 3, and 4. So we do section 1 and section 3. If you would stand up and face the center aisles, and from the rear, if you would then come from the last aisle and come up, and then after that, we will call sections 2 and 4.
Thank you. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within him. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and forget not all of his benefits. Well, preacher, what are his benefits? Well, he has forgiven all of thine iniquities. Anybody want to give God praise for that? And he has healed all of our diseases. Did you say all, preacher? I say it all. He redeemeth thy life from destruction. He crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercy. He satisfied thy feet, their youth with wings of eagles. Let's give God some praise in the house. He is worthy of all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. We are glad to be in the house of the Lord once again. It's good to see all my brothers and sisters. And I know we asked, were there any visitors? We didn't send out letters and all those types of things for our revival. This is pretty much the family coming together. This is COVID-19, but God can't stop our praise. Can I get some help in the house? He cannot stop our revival. Yep, we got to be smart about what we do, but we still bless the Lord and we honor the Lord. And I want to say it's good to see everybody in the sanctuary. Give God praise that you're in the sanctuary. Amen. We praise God for all of our Facebook Live audience. Give God praise for the Facebook Live. And we praise God for our teleconference. Thank you so much for supporting Oak Grove Baptist Church. And I'm glad to be able to have a revival 2021. Let me say before we go on to introducing the speaker, I want to say thank you to the congregation. You know that I had a really significant weekend. The first thing that happened on Friday was it was my birthday. Amen. Give God. And I want to say thank you to Ann Mack. Mack, I can't leave you out. It was Mack's birthday too. And Emily and a few other people around here. I know the birthday is on the 30th. But that was also the day that we traveled down to Georgia to be a part of my family. Thank you for your prayers. My uncle passed away, the last of my father's siblings, and we wanted to be down there, and Karen and I drove 400 miles one way to get down to South Georgia, 400 miles back, and guess what? The Lord protected us, and I know it was because of the prayers of the saints, so thank you so much. Thank you for praying for us, and certainly we were glad to be able to be a part of the family. You know, as I get older, the family is just so much more important. I just have to take the time. I know we had homecoming on yesterday, but we connected with you all on our Facebook Live on our way drive back, and we thank God for all that has happened on yesterday. But thank God that we were able to go down there. Amen, amen. Now, the last thing I have, and not you know, last but not least, it is preaching time in the house of the Lord. Amen, amen. And as I was thinking about, well, preacher, how do I introduce this great pastor, this great teacher, this great mentor? I started off with thinking about what 2020 bought us. You know, there was a lot that we were surprised about, but I want to say to Oak Grove Baptist Church, when the enemy came in like a flood, we didn't just sit there and scare, but we prayed. Can I get some amens in the house? We had an intercessory prayer group that prayed every day, and anybody remember those Tuesday nights? Anybody remember those Tuesday nights? We thank God. But we were also studying the Word of God. We were investing in God, and I call that we were building the cake. Amen. We were putting together the cake and all the different ingredients that come with the cake. But everybody know a good cake every once in a while, you need some icing on that cake. And I believe that that's what this revival is really all about. And I've been asked the Lord to seek, search me, look at me. What is it that I need to do? Because I really think revival is a personal thing. And I think if you begin to ask God, God, seek, I'm seeking you, but search me, search my heart, create in me a clean heart, and renew the right spirit within me. And I believe the Lord will hear our prayers tonight. And so I'm glad to be able to introduce this great man of God. I don't know how long I've been knowing Reverend Dr. Wherry, but I know that I am so glad that I met him many, many years ago. and he is just a great brother. He's a strong preacher. He's a profound, intelligent, strong black man committed to the Lord. Amen. But the thing about it, he's still down to earth. Amen. That's what I like about the brother. He is very humble. But I just want to read to you, and I don't want to insult your intelligence, but I just want to take the time out to say something here about our friend and Reverend Dr. Wherry. And it's right here in the program, and I'm going to read half of it tonight, and I'll read the other half tomorrow night. So a 41-year veteran of Christian ministry, pastor, scholar, and musician, the Reverend Dr. Peter M. Wherry is a native of Buffalo, New York. He earned his honors, the Bachelor's of Arts degree in social work and gerontology from Virginia Union University, and a Master of Divinity degree from the Samuel DeWitt Proctor School of Theology at Virginia Union, both in Richmond, Virginia. He earned a Doctor of Ministry degree from the Wesley Theological Seminary in Washington, D.C. Dr. Wherry also holds a certificate in church management, awarded jointly by ITC, which is the Interdenominational Theological Center in Atlanta, Georgia, and the Samuel DeWitt Proctor School of Theology. He has been guest lecturers in the Doctor of Ministry programs at Regent University in Virginia Beach, Virginia, and Samuel DeWitt Proctor School of Theology, where he is an adjunct faculty member having taught Bible history. Well, all of that is good, but I came to tell you that we have a preacher who is called by the Lord. Can I get an amen? We have a preacher who has studied and has studied well, and he is ready to break the bread of life. And so we're going to ask the choir to come back with another selection, and the next voice you will hear will be that of Reverend Dr. Peter M. Wherry. Hear ye him. Somebody say praise the Lord. Somebody say hallelujah. And somebody say thank God. God bless you. We're going to ask the choir to come now, and we'll continue on with our worship. Give God praise for the choir. Thank you.
How many know there is no other way? I've tried everything else, but there's no other way I can live without the Lord. Hallelujah. I know that's right. So glad to be here with two of the flat-out nicest people I've ever known. That is Pastor Frank Watkins and Lady Watkins with her gracious, kind self. Thank you. Amen. I am honored to have been asked to share this revival experience with you. One of the things that I remember so fondly about Oak Grove, among the many, is the sincere enthusiasm of the singers in this church. This unity choir is just what I needed. The Bible is clear that where there is unity, amen, there is strength, there is love. And so thank God for our worship leader, Reverend Alsop, and for the Reverend clergy scattered around, and for the members of Oak Grove here and remote. We thank God for all of you. I am serious about revival, and I know that you've been praying. I know somebody's been praying, because I got to see two friends I haven't seen. You know, all of us have been locked in for the most part for over a year and a half. And there's so many people that we've missed, and two of them are here tonight, the Muakils, Pastor and Lady Muakil from the Life Baptist Church in the valley where we are. So I thank God for seeing you all tonight as well. So from the gospel according to Mark chapter 1, beginning with verse 21, I'm going to read it from the Good News Translation, whatever version or translation you have, please follow along. Mark chapter 1, verses 21 through 28. When you found it, would you just say amen? Jesus and his disciples came to the town of Capernaum, and on the next Sabbath, Jesus went to the synagogue and began to teach. The people who heard him were amazed at the way he talked, for he wasn't like the teachers of the law. Instead, he taught with authority, Just then, a man with an evil spirit came into the synagogue and screamed, "What do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Are you here to destroy us? I know who you are. You are God's holy messenger." Jesus ordered the spirit, "Be quiet and come out of the man." The evil spirit shook the man hard, gave a loud scream, and came out of him. The people were all so amazed that they started saying to one another, "What is this? Is it some kind of new teaching? This man has authority to give orders to evil spirits, and they obey him." And so the news about Jesus spread quickly everywhere in the province of Galilee. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Pray with me for a few minutes tonight. I want to talk about good news in the ghetto. Good news in the ghetto. Let us pray. Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope. Let my will be lost in thine. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. It was the Sabbath. So, as usual, the Jews of the ghetto went to the synagogue. The word ghetto has been loaded with so much cultural baggage these days that it almost obscures the fact that before a gold grill in a dude's mouth became ghetto, ghetto used to describe the place where poor folk lived. Oh, since medieval days in Europe where the first ghettos were created, the word ghetto has never meant anything positive. How could it be a positive thing for people to be forced to live in intentionally planned pockets of poverty? But at least before hip-hop culture got hold of the term, it used to mostly mean the place where we lived. It was the Sabbath. So as usual, the Jews of the ghetto went to the synagogue. Some of them were a little preoccupied as they went to sit down. One mother was overheard telling her four children in a growling whisper, "Now don't you let me have to separate y'all from each other. You better act like you got some home training. Jaquan, I thought I told you to leave that toy at home. Open up, all of you. Put that gum in this tissue. Come on." The old couple, Mr. and Mrs. Thompson, sat quietly near the front, reading the bulletin as if it were a newspaper. They always looked bored, no matter what was going on. A young woman way at the back pulled and tugged at the hemline of her skirt. An old man seemed to be taking too much notice of how short it was. Mothers took little jars of Vaseline, and all over the place you could see them rubbing it into their children's shiny, now shiny little faces that used to be ashy, and firmly smeared it all over deeply annoyed little frowning faces. It was the Sabbath. So, as usual, the Jews of the ghetto went to the synagogue. All over the room, people began to roll their eyes, and some eyed the back door as if they might tip out
when one by one they started to notice in the bulletin that the guest preacher for today was a young dude from Nazareth. Oh, Lord. Brother Simpkins muttered to his friend, I hope he knows how to bring that thing in for a landing before the pregame show. His brow furrowed as he pondered how he needed time to adjust the coat hanger on his old TV because he couldn't pay the cable bill. It was the Sabbath. So, as usual, Jews of the ghetto went to the synagogue. As usual, that is, until this fellow Jesus stood up and took his text. There was something strange, something different about this young preacher. When the scribes taught, they were good at it and all, but it was clear that they were teaching about God. When Jesus taught, it was as if he actually knew God. You got the feeling that he had spent a long time with God. Sometimes he spoke as if he was God. It wasn't that his hoop was down pat. He didn't hoop like John the Baptist did. He didn't wear any eye-catching robe like John either. He just had authority. He seemed to command the place. In this way that even made the folk who usually sleep in church sit up and pay attention. Mr. Creasy didn't have to wake up to say amen. It was amazing, but Miss Cook wasn't figuring her bills on the back of the bulletin. Teenagers were sitting up straight and not slouching, and they didn't even sneak out to go buy candy at the store across the street. Just this man being in the room seemed to change everything. Immediately, a brother sitting at the back started to scream and talk out all over Jesus. He said the strangest thing. He said, what do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us already? He said, I know who you are. You are God's holy messenger. Then the real fireworks started. Jesus looked in on the brother and he started talking to the spirit that people were whispering was in the man. Jesus locked eyes with him and Jesus said to the spirit in a stern voice, shut up. That's my translation. Shut up and come out of the man. Now that doesn't happen every week either. The guy shook like a leaf in the wind and screamed. Then he just fell on the floor in a pile. Church hadn't been this exciting since Sister Bracy got happy and all her money fell out of her pocketbook. Folks' mouths were wide open. Nobody could say a word. Sister Cooper scribbled on the bottom of her bulletin and showed it to Sister Boone. What in the world? It was a day, y'all, that nobody will ever forget. Brother Mark wrote it all up in the Ghetto Good News, the synagogue newsletter. He titled the story, and so the news about Jesus spread quickly everywhere in the province of Galilee. The story was compelling. Mark explained that the good news about Jesus had three components. Jesus has authority over tradition. Jesus has authority over evil. And Jesus has authority over the ghetto. That's all Brother Mark wrote in his newsletter. Can I just tell you a little bit about the little articles that he wrote? The first article he wrote is this: Jesus has authority over tradition. He named this one verse 21. Jesus and his disciples came to the town of Capernaum, and on the next Sabbath, Jesus went to the synagogue and began to teach. a literal translation of verse 21, because y'all know Brother Mark wrote it in Greek, would sound something like this. Jesus and his disciples were coming into Capernaum, and watch this, immediately the Sabbath arrived and he taught in the synagogue. The translation's revealing, Oak Grove, because instead of the Sabbath coming and then Jesus comes into Capernaum after this, Mark's language gives us the impression that when Jesus came into town, the Sabbath followed him. Y'all stay with me, I'm going somewhere. The tradition of the Sabbath observance was powerful and was then one of the signs of a believer's faithfulness to God. This was, after all, a commandment. Don't y'all remember the Lord said it? Honor the Sabbath day and keep it holy. Here now, Mark indicates in his newsletter, by his use of language, that Jesus did not follow the Sabbath, but rather the Sabbath follows Jesus. Traditions, y'all, are powerful things. They ground us and connect us to our history. I heard Reverend Alsop mention 130 years, 131 years. A lot of traditions can happen in 131 years. They're powerful things. They anchor us. They ground us. They connect us to our history. Traditions are the mile markers along the way that remind us of where we've been and how far we've traveled. Traditions reinforce for us the meanings of the stuff we've been through. Brother Mark, in his synagogue letter, though, makes it very clear that Jesus did not come to wipe out traditions. He just came to take authority over them. Yeah, the way that most folk and institutions fall into trouble, Pastor, with traditions is that they start to treat the tradition as if it were holy. God help me to preach your word. Jesus stands up in front of the gathering tonight and he declares that traditions can be good, but only he is holy. Mark's language sets up an arrangement in the sentence and in the text that proclaims the supremacy of Jesus over Sabbath tradition and over every tradition. This is vital for everybody who's ever been oppressed by tradition. Y'all do remember the days when tradition oppressed us. It was not any biblical law that we were less than anybody else, but somehow the framers of the United States Constitution saw fit to build into that document of origination called the Constitution that we were three-fifths of a human being. Traditions can oppress. Tradition is all about what we've always done. Don't forget there were a lot of women who were oppressed and boxed out of leadership in the church and in the community. Couldn't even vote till 1920. Traditions can oppress. Tradition is all about we've never done it that way before. Jesus comes saying, don't foreclose while you're honoring the tradition on what I can do right now. Tradition venerates the past. Jesus comes to enlarge and to energize the present and to activate the future. Tradition talks about who you were. Jesus makes real who you can be. I'm so glad I have tradition, because if it wasn't for tradition, I wouldn't have the moorings of a lot of people in this church, because I didn't come up like y'all. I never went to a vacation Bible school until I got preaching and got a call to preach. That was the first VBS I ever attended. I hadn't been baptized till I was a grown man. I lived in the buckle of the ghetto. I lived right in the ghetto, so that everybody I knew was either getting killed or being sent down south to get away from gangs so they wouldn't get killed. I'm so glad I had the traditions of the church to ground me and to anchor me and to teach me. But y'all know what? I'm also glad Jesus had authority over the tradition, because there were a whole lot of people who would have kept me out if it had not been for Jesus coming into my life and teaching like he had authority, not about God, but like he knew God, like he was God. Here, Brother Mark writes in his newsletter, Jesus has authority over tradition. Aren't you glad about it? Because there are a whole lot of folk in America right now who think it's a good tradition that we ought not vote. Whole lot of folk in America right now who think it's a good tradition that if I don't like who won the election, I can just change the election to make it like I want it. Whole lot of people in America right now who don't believe that voters ought to choose their representatives. They believe representatives by law ought to choose their own voters. Can you say gerrymander? Jesus has authority. Aren't you glad? Over tradition. Page 2 of Brother Mark's Good News from the Ghetto Synagogue newsletter had this headline. He said, Jesus has authority over evil. Watch verse 23. Verse 23 says, just then. There's another adverbial phrase. You English scholars ought to know that whenever you see an adverb or an adverbial phrase, it's telling you what time it is. In other words, when an adverb shows up, it's telling you God is about to do something. When you see him in the scriptures, God is about to do something that's going to supersede that which has been done before. Kind of like a contravening conjunction, only when an adverb shows up, it's action time. Jesus has authority over evil. Verse 23 says, just then a man with an evil spirit came into the synagogue and screamed, what do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Are you here to destroy us? I know who you are. You are God's holy messenger. Jesus ordered the spirit, shut up, be quiet, and come out of the man. The evil spirit shook the man hard, gave a loud scream, and came out of him. This word, this adverbial phrase in the Good News, just then, if you translate literally from the Greek, the word sounds like this, immediately. Mark is full of that word, immediately. All throughout the book, the action moves from point to point using this word, an adverb, immediately. A spirit-possessed man shouts from the back. It isn't at all remarkable that a spirit-possessed man was in the crowd. Can I shock y'all? Spirit-possessed folk are likely present in every gathering of believers. Yeah, there are a lot of folk who have a spirit, but not everybody who comes to church has the spirit that is of God. They're dealing with some spirit, but it ain't always the Holy Spirit. Oh, I know that don't happen at Oak Grove. Can I just talk about what happens over in the valley, Brother Makiel? There are some folk who come. Every gathering of believers, I don't care how holy, I don't care how righteous, I don't care how many, I don't care what denomination, I don't care what culture. In every gathering of believers, there is somebody who is possessed by a spirit. Now, what's really remarkable is that as soon as Jesus got up to speak, the spirit couldn't hold its peace. Scribe after scribe has been up in front of that same room, and the context of this story suggests that at no time did any evil spirit speak up. Mark's urgent language here and his second use of the Greek word meaning immediately suggests that there's power in Jesus that forced the demonic power out into the open. Ghettos, family, are places where evil spirits abound. So a savior who has power over evil spirits is good news every day of the week. Ghettos are places where evil spirits abound because evil things have been done to good people all over a ghetto. Ghettos are places where evil spirits abound because people in those places are often broken by what evil has done to them. Ghettos are places where evil spirits abound because in ghetto places, people lose their perspective on the value of life and young people kill each other all day long. Ghettos are places where evil spirits abound because in ghettos women are not always safe, and most women in those places have been molested or harassed or mistreated or put down or objectified or subjugated. Ghettos are places where evil spirits abound. There's a systemic structural evil in which folk have set up unjust systems to oppress others. There's redlining, there's racism, there's gerrymandering, there's voter suppression, there's police brutality, there's killings, there's crack, there's meth, there's ice, there's crank. Mark's message is that he witnessed Jesus stand up and call the evil out. His mere presence, Oak Grove, called the evil out. Oh, that's a shout cue for somebody who's wrestled with evil in your life. Just the presence of Jesus. God, I feel like preaching in here. Just the presence of Jesus will call evil out. His presence, y'all, is prophetic. His presence is powerful. It's potent. It's productive. And those who heard him in the service and with whom he's in solidarity and with whom he walks in the society, we've got to speak with his voice and act with his vision. When we do that, Jesus shows up in our spaces. The Hebrews had an ancient name theology that said whenever you call a person's name, a name has meaning in Hebrew culture, and whenever you called their name, a piece of their essence showed up in the place. Can I tell you that Jesus is calling out evil spirits just because we call his name? When you name that name Jesus, they already know. They've been given some marching orders. Every knee must bow, and every tongue must confess that Jesus is Lord. Can I get some witnesses to say he's Lord over the evil in my life? He's Lord over the brokenness in my circumstance. He's Lord over the destructive systems that keep me down. He's Lord over the stuff I can't handle by myself. Jesus is Lord over tradition, Lord over the stiff-necked folk who kept you down, Lord over the mean, recalcitrant supervisor who passed you over, Lord over the banks that redlined your community. He's Lord over evil. But Brother Mark wrote another page in his newsletter, though, Good News from the Ghetto. It had just one more headline. It says, Jesus has authority over the ghetto. What? He says, verse 28, he calls this one. He says, and so, the news about Jesus spread quickly everywhere in the province of Galilee. And so you could translate that same from the Greek, immediately. That is, as soon as this thing went down, they didn't even have PDFs. They didn't have text messages. They didn't have anything, direct messages and instant. No, they didn't have none of that. But immediately, what happened in church that day spread everywhere around the ghetto called Galilee. Galilee was a ghetto because during the time of Solomon, all of the natural resources that were needed to build Solomon's temple were stripped from Galilee. Galilee was the place where there was questionable religion because the right place to worship was in Jerusalem. Galilee was the place where there was just a remnant of what it used to be, the northern kingdom where heavy-stepping prophets used to preach. Now Galilee was a ghetto, and all over that ghetto, after Jesus got through reading in the synagogue, the book says, in one version, it says that when he got through, he chose that sentence, those sentences from the servant song of Isaiah, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. God, I feel my help in here now, because he has anointed me to preach deliverance to the captives and good news to the poor, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord's favor. And he looked at his audience and he said, this day, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. Oh, that's what I like about Jesus. He knew who he was. He had authority over the ghetto. That's what he was proclaiming. The saying, of course, is that there's an old saying, bad news will travel around the world twice before good news puts her shoes on. This saying gets to the fact, y'all, that folk love to carry and report bad news. It's the bad news that makes the newspaper and TV headlines and the news feeds online. It's the bad news that makes it onto the chyrons and banners across the screen on CNN and MSNBC. Every time you turn on, bump, 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 breaking news. It ain't never no good news. It's mostly bad news. It's usually the bad news that flashes in the middle of the TV screen and gets labeled like that, breaking news. Folk, it seems, have a morbid sense of curiosity when bad news is breaking. Have you ever noticed driving down the interstate? The lanes of traffic are open, but if there's a near fatal accident, a big crack up on the side of the road, everybody in line slows down like they ain't got nowhere to drive, and the road is wide open. What's happening? They're just rubbernecking, trying to see what's going on, because we love bad news. But this 28th verse points up the reality that depending on how good it is, good news can travel fast too. Can I talk about it? When the word got out about what Jesus had done, folk, the text says, began to spread it like wildfire. The reason for this is because the news of what Jesus had done flew in the face of everything that keeps a ghetto a ghetto. Everything that keeps a ghetto, dilapidated dreams, run-down reality, evil influences, destructive infestations, breakdown of the civilized social order, irrelevant religious ritualism, corrupt institutions, festering hopelessness. That's why this move was news. Nobody had ever spoken to these forces and gotten a rise out of them, but when Jesus spoke to them all, he said, shut up, and the demon shut up. God, I'm so glad I know him. Jesus said, come out, and the demon came out. The old church used to put it like this: what a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my life. Can I fast forward? Floods of joy o'er my soul, like the sea billows roll, since Jesus came into my life. Somebody else said it like this: shackled neath a heavy burden, neath a load of guilt and shame, then the hand of Jesus touched me, and now I'm no longer the same. Can I tell you that at just one word from Jesus, every demon in hell has to tremble? As just one word from Jesus, sick bodies have got to get well, which caused James to tell the faithful, you just have the elders come and lay hands on the sick and they will recover. At just one word from Jesus, poverty can flee, because he can speak, your faith has made you whole. At just one word from Jesus, then darkness and burdens were washed away. Isaiah saw him through a glass darkly. He said, don't you worry, one day is coming. Every valley shall be exalted, and every hill and mountain shall be made low. Rough places will be made plain, and crooked places will be made straight. Here's the news flash: everybody, all flesh, shall see it together. I'm so glad, Oak Grove, Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad, y'all, he spoke a word to my sin-sick soul. And I've been running ever since. Every time Jesus speaks, the ghetto gets smaller. I dare you this week, just speak his name. I dare you this week, just draw a little Jesus into the space that you're fighting through. I dare you tomorrow, draw some Jesus into the burdens that you've been bearing. I dare you this week, draw some Jesus into the complications of your family situation. I dare you this week to draw some Jesus into your depressed financial situation. I dare you to draw some Jesus into your COVID reality. I don't know about y'all. I'm through preaching. Can I just testify? I don't know about y'all, but I had COVID-19. It was at a time when we didn't really know what what to do about it. Nobody knew really what to tell you. I was down on my back and I could not breathe. I could not speak. I coughed every time I took a breath. I hurt so bad over my entire body that I didn't want to get up out of the bed. I was so sick I couldn't raise up my head. But somehow, in the midst of the sickness, every Sunday, God got me up out of the bed and let me drag myself in front of the camera and declare Jesus has authority over the ghetto. Yeah! Every Sunday, he let me stand up somehow and speak his name. And y'all know what? The more I called him, the more I felt him. I wish somebody would know Jesus is a healer. Yes, every time I called him, I found myself getting better. Couldn't breathe, couldn't taste nothing, couldn't smell nothing, couldn't remember nothing. But right now, in the name of Jesus, by his stripes, I am healed. Have I got a witness in here? By his blood, I've been made whole. Yeah, I'm so glad. Thank you. I'm so glad Jesus came to church tonight to speak his sovereignty over traditions, to speak his sovereignty over evil, and even over the ghettos that got us locked in. I know that's bad grammar, but it's good gospel. Are you glad about it? Hallelujah. This is a moment when we are obligated, if the things the text has said are true, a response is necessary. And so if you're here tonight, I know no finer pastor or church than Oak Grove. If you don't have one, you need one. First, you need Jesus in your life. Romans 10 and 9 says, if you confess with your mouth, didn't y'all hear it tonight? The Lord Jesus, and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. The Greek says sozo. You will be thoroughgoingly changed. Your family tree will never be the same again. He's waiting for you if you don't know him for yourself. Won't you come? Give him your life. Give him your heart. Give him yourself, all of you. Isn't it ironic that the power we need, we so often resist? Because the trouble that we know sometimes seems preferable to the glory we don't yet know. Don't let that be your testimony. We're opening the doors symbolically of the church, which Jesus opened on Calvary. If you don't know this Christ, colloquially speaking, on a first name basis, as your own Savior, you ought to come. Hallelujah. He's able to change you. Hallelujah. A change, oh, change has come over me. He changed my life, and now I'm free. He washed away all my sins, and he made me
hold. He washed me. No, he changed my life complete, and now I sit at his feet to do what must be done. I'll work and work until he comes. Wonderful change, wonderful change. My Savior's feet, to do what must be done. I'm gonna work and work until he comes. I'm not what I wanna be. Oh, I'm not what I used to be. I'm not the same. Thank God, it changed my walk, y'all. Yeah, it changed my talk, y'all. He changed my life, he even changed my soul. A wonderful, wonderful change. Wonderful change has
come on. Let's thank God for a saved house.
Sanctuary and altar today. What a powerful word that we've heard. And give God praise again for Reverend Dr. Peter Wherry, Pastor of Mayfield Memorial. But let's call in the name of the Lord at this time. Lord, we give you honor, we give you glory, we magnify your name. We thank you, God, for this word today. Good news in the ghetto. We know the ghetto could mean what we're going through. The ghetto could mean the bad situations that we're having to deal with. The ghetto can mean the ghetto of our hearts. But we pray in the name of Jesus right now that you would touch every person, everybody that's in the pews, everybody that's in the choir stand, this entire sanctuary, those in Facebook land. We pray in the name of Jesus that you would touch right now in the name of Jesus, in the power of your might, in the power of your name, God. We praise you right now, and we thank you for that touch. We thank you for that word. Now help us to walk it out, God. Help us to live it out, Lord God. Help us to believe it and help us to put it in the right place, that it will come up, that we will know that we are truly children of God. Now we pray, God, for the messenger today. We ask that you would just continue to strengthen him. We thank you for Reverend Dr. Peter Wherry. Thank you, God, for using him tonight. Now build him up right now and give him the strength to come back and declare the Lord once again on tomorrow. We thank you, God, even right now. We thank you for the speaker, God. We thank you for the choir right now. We praise the Lord for the choir and the musicians, Lord, as they have sung Zion songs. And we pray that you would give them even stronger conviction that they will come back tomorrow night on fire for the Lord. We pray right now for the ushers. We pray right now for the greeters. We pray right now for all the Oak Grove Missionary, Oak Grove Baptist Church that's in the house today, God. We say, thank you, Lord. We bless your name. Now bless us now. Thank you for this revival. Thank you for allowing us to be here tonight. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Let everybody say amen. Amen. And give God some praise once again. He is worthy of all the glory, the honor, and praise. I want to say thank you again to our choir, our musicians. Give it up again for them. Beautiful. Just fantastic job. Every time we hear you singing, I might want to join you one Sunday. You might be surprised. I may come up over there and start singing. I got to go to the baritone section, though. I know I'm just playing. I'm just kidding. Thank you. Thank you, Breon and all the, and Mac and Josh and all the musicians. Give God praise for the musicians. Let's give God praise for our ushers and our greeters, our deacons, all of our officers. Give God praise for our sound, audio video team that's right there doing a great job every time. Amen, amen, amen. I do want to say thank you to my real good friend, Abdul and Mary Milwaukee. Give God praise for them. It's always good to see the Milwaukeeans, and they will always come and see about us. Now, you know, we said this is for the family, but it's okay for the family to invite other people. If you want something, invite some people, go ahead and do that, because we got one more night. Amen. One more night of revival. And we are so thankful the Lord has placed it on our hearts. I know we're not back to normal yet, but there are some things that I'm just so glad that the Lord placed on our hearts. We can take a couple of steps to try to get back to a little bit of what we were doing before. But let me tell you something. I'm so thankful that I'm learning that now is the time to give God some show enough praise. I mean, he has brought us through. He has done some good things. And we ought to say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Well, we're about ready to have Peter Wherry to come back, but I just wanted to say again, thank you all. It's a great crowd. It's a great crowd of witnesses today, and we look forward to what the Lord is going to say today. But I always know where the message starts. It starts with our prayers. Go ahead and let's pray tonight. Let's pray in the morning. Let's pray during the midday and ask God to start that revival in me. Build me up. Make me to be who you have called me to be. And watch the Lord do it. We thank God for this message today. Good news in the ghetto. Amen. Authority over tradition. Authority over evil. And authority over the ghetto. Amen. God bless everybody. We're going to now ask our speaker to come back. So glad to have my brother once again to come back to us. Because I think, Dr. Wherry, you were here. I looked at it. I think it was 16 and 17, 20. 2016 and 2017, but we're so glad to have you come back, and you bless us, my brother.
It is my honor. Thank you, sir.
Give God praise for him once again.
So, Oak Grove, thank you for your prayerful spirits. You always are. Thank you for your warm hospitality. I'm grateful to be a part of this process this week. And so if you've heard anything tonight, which you can affirm to be the truth that I want to teach. I think I taught y'all a little Greek when I came here last time. I want to teach that same lesson over again. If you want to say that anything you have heard tonight has been the truth, there's one way in Greek to say it is so. Y'all remember what that is? Amen. Everybody sing amen. Everybody sing. Everybody sing. Amen. Amen. Everybody sing. Everybody sing. Everybody sing. Amen. Amen. One more time. Everybody sing. Amen. Everybody sing. Everybody sing. Amen. Amen. Would you repeat after me? If everybody in this revival pray just like me, what kind of revival would this one be? See you tomorrow night.